I'm sorry.
Hey, no, that's okay. I'm Mark Musway. I'm running for coroner here in the county. I just never met you.
Well, they say share the road, but there's three classes of cyclists.
To your recording tone.
Class B and Class C are people who are not in the roadway all the time. Yep.
Thank you.
They're not even knowledgeable.
Uh-huh. Sorry.
Nydia?
Yes.
Welcome.
Good morning. Good morning. Good afternoon.
Good evening.
Hi.
Hi.
Me and Terry Sweeney work in the door.
Oh, okay. Chief.
Hi, Mr. Sweeney. Here's a good
keeping the peace. At your will.
It is Brian. It is Brian. Kevin.
So my name is Claudia Castro. I'm the managing director of Smart Growth for Forsyth County. We've been in existence since the spring of 2005. This is not our first rodeo. We've done this before. We've had meet candidates to meet at South Forsyth High School. We had meet candidate forums at our monthly meetings some years back. And 2 years ago, we also held meet candidates forums such as this in this very venue. We pride ourselves on the fact that this commissioner forum is open to all the political parties. In the at the last political event we had debate that we had at the high school, there were Democrats and Republicans present, and that's the type of group we'd like to consider ourselves, open to all parties and giving you, the citizens, an opportunity to hear from the people who really would like to set Forsyth County on a certain path. And the decisions that they're going to be making are going to affect you as residents long after they're removed from office, or they leave office, or they move away and retire. So this is important for you to get a chance to know who they are and what their views are on growth and development in Forsyth County. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the Smart Growth team, Derucki, our treasurer, for baking the brownies. Those are the brown brownies. Jack Leeson, who's our environmental compliance officer. Hey, Jack. Susan Foster, where'd she go? There she is, Susan, who's the deputy director, and in my right hand. And who are we missing? Kirk Winterstein. He gave you your raffle ticket today. He's our secretary, and we're glad to have him on board. He is the man of many hats. And Rick Scissors, without being asked, good man. A reminder, we do have refreshments, water, coffee. The coffee is caffeinated. That's to help you stay awake tonight. The brownies and the blondies are courtesy of the crew here. We welcome you. We ask you to please be polite, remain courteous. This is an opportunity for you to really have an intimate look at your candidates. And with that, I would like to turn the forum over to Bob Slaughter, who is Smart Growth's founder. Thank you so much for coming.
Well, good evening. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Claudia, for putting this together. We founded Smart Growth in 2005 specifically as a nonpartisan organization, and truest to the community roots of being entirely grassroots, entirely volunteer organization, open to all. And we have maintained that nonpartisan stance and actually guarded that stance over the years, and we will continue to do so. And so tonight, we're holding yet another candidate forum, because in our view, as the economy slowly recovers, we feel that in the next 2 to 4 years, we're on the cusp of the next wave of development in Forsyth County. And we feel that this board in particular will have some great impact on the trajectory of where the county is going to go. And so we feel the next 4 years are critical. And the challenge that's going to be before this board is whether or not they can show us that they have learned from the experiences of the last 10 to 15 years of development in this county, both the successes and the mistakes. And so tonight we're hoping that each of the candidates will be able to successfully articulate how they're going to meet that challenge over the next 4 years. Some quick administrative notes. If you have a cell phone, please turn it off so that we don't have any interruptions during the the presentation. Bathroom is in the back on the right-hand side. We're going to run roughly till 9:15. We can probably go longer until they kick us out. We'll just see how that goes. There's a donation pot back there. Smart Growth paid for this building from the chamber. It was $60. So if you have a couple of spare quarters or something, throw it in the pot so that we can pay for the room. I am the MC. I have my sergeant at arms back there, Jack Gleason.
And Terry Sweeney.
And Terry Sweeney. The watchword for tonight is to be civil and informative. This is not a debate. This is an opportunity for the candidates to tell us what they're going to do for us or what they want to do for us as candidates. We're going to start by asking them to capture the first three questions that we sent out to them. And I'm going to read those to you so you have some context. But I'm going to give them each an opportunity to make an opening statement. I'm going to ask if they keep it to 3 minutes apiece. So that's a bit of time. You can go shorter if you want. Brandy is always accepted. But the first three questions are fairly involved. And so we're going to ask them to try to, as best they can, sort of capture and roll those questions up. And then we're going to pick and choose through some of the smart growth questions. How many folks here have seen the question? Please raise your hand. Okay. So not many. They were in the paper. I think they directed them to the website. But I'll read each question beforehand. And then, unlike in the past, we thought we would intersperse audience questions as we go through. And then save the last 30 to 45 minutes simply for the audience to ask questions. The way it goes with the audience is if you put your name down, you got a raffle ticket, we'll pull the ticket and you get to ask your question. A quick note on how to ask and how to answer. How to ask. This is a civil body here. So if you're difficult, Jack will throw you out the window. Please be specific. Try to keep your question as specifically oriented to an issue. As best you can. If you have a question that affects the entire county, then please be patient and allow every person at this table to respond to the countywide question. On the flip side of that, candidates, if you do not differentiate your position from one of the other candidates, just say so. It's okay. Maybe you want to add a few words, maybe not. But in the interest of time, I would ask that you do that. And if you have a question for a specific district, then allow the other both districts to candidates to respond. And then I would ask, because we're not going to go through all the smart growth questions, there's too many questions for us to do in time, I would like to ask the candidates, if you have prepared something in writing, if you would email that to us, we would like to post that on our forum so that folks can have access to that. You can, you know, wordsmith it. I end up after this. All right. Are there any questions before I get started? All right. The first three questions that were presented to the candidates. In 250 words or less, sounds like an essay, explain your vision for the county over the next 20 years. Please include in your vision what you feel is the core nature of the county. Is it a business community, a bedroom community, is it a vacation destination? What is it that you think Forsyth County should aspire to be? What is the aesthetic that you're looking for? What will it feel like to live here? In that discussion, in your opening statement, if you can get to it, please list in priority what you think the top three challenges are to both the county and your district in specific. So that's a lot. And so we're going to push you guys as hard as we can in a civil way. Put your thinking caps on. And we're going to start from left to right. We'll start with Brian Tam, District 2 incumbent. Brian?
Ready? First of all, thank you very much. Appreciate you taking the time to come out and your interest in Forsyth County government. My vision really started 8 years ago when I took office. shortly after realigning the Mathis Airport Parkway. I sought citizen input, and that's what it begins with, citizen input, for the Peachtree Parkway overlay. It speaks to standards for the architectural landscaping and setbacks along 141. Moving forward, I see a CID formed, Community Improvement District, for 141. I presented this to the General Assembly and to the Chamber of Commerce, and I think by this time next year, it can be a reality. I see continued enhancement of what I call the big three: education, recreation, public safety. As a commissioner, it's paramount to work with other branches of government. I've sat on local school councils for the past 9 years.
Brian, can you speak louder, please?
Absolutely.
You may stand. If you want to take your podium, you can do that.
No, I'm okay. And working with the school system has resulted in joint venture recreation, outdoor classrooms, and infrastructure sharing. Moving forward, I sit on the advisory committee for North Georgia College, which, if you don't know, in August will open its doors to Forsyth County residents. They're building a new campus right up on Pilgrim Mill Road. We must support the continued expansion of higher education in our county. Recreation. Within the next 30 days, over 250 acres of passive and active recreation will open for the public to enjoy in South Forsyth. This is a result of the Parks Recreation and Green Space Bond that I initiated. I think we should familiarize ourselves with the master plan, that's the Parks and Recreation Master Plan, and continue investing in these amenities as they add property values and will help our local economy. Public safety. I was able to work with other branches of government to help bring a sheriff's precinct next to South Forsyth High School. Moving forward, we need to continue to invest in public safety, adding fire stations, law enforcement facilities, and fire engines, mostly using sales tax dollars, as we've done in the past, that keeps our property taxes low. Overall, I think we should be investing in interconnectivity with sidewalks and multi-use trails similar to the ones that are being added to the Old Atlanta Corridor. We need to encourage quality, well-placed development, such as the Avenue Forsyth, hopefully bringing the Talbin Project to fruition, and the expansion of children's health care that will complement our already existing quality health care system and provide quality jobs for years, if not decades, to come. I see the elimination of private sewer plants, and I'm at 250. You said 250?
10 seconds.
The elimination of private sewer plants and the cooperative solution with the City of Cumming for a redundant intake.
Okay. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Can I?
Around? Sure.
You might be able to hear me a little better. Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dennis Brown. I'm running for Commissioner District 2. I've lived in Forsyth County for 14 years, resident of Cobb County originally, and we live in a wonderful county. So I've got a prepared statement here. I think I'm going to spend a lot of time on it, and I'm going to defer to it. Quality, 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 not quantity. My vision is for Forsyth County to be the global destination of choice for quality, top-tier business and residents, a county that is safe to walk the streets any time of day or night, a county that recognizes and preserves its natural resources and beauty while maintaining quality schools and resources to attract high-tech business startups and global Fortune 500 companies and headquarters. In short, a place that all residents are proud to call home. We need to remain a premier county nationally and not make the same mistakes that many other high potential counties have made, falling victim to urban blight and overgrowth. Our Forsyth should have world-class amenities constructed and maintained with an awareness and respect for our natural beauty and resources already present in Forsyth County, blended naturally to preserve our heritage of the past with a strong and vibrant vision for the future. We proudly call Lake Lanier ours, which is a vacation destination in our own backyard, that we must maintain. Forsyth County represents the mountain gateway to North Georgia, close enough to Atlanta, but far away to maintain a much better quality of life. In Forsyth County, we are uniquely positioned to have it all. We have done a lot of great things. If we can continue to build on what we've done, I think Forsyth County can be a global destination, both residential and business-wise. And there's a lot of details within that. The three topics that I see are the most pressing issues are growth and development, transportation and congestion, and water. And I think those are the same for the county as a whole, notwithstanding Lake Lanier. Growth and development, the county will grow. It's inevitable. It just depends on how much, how fast, and how fast and how much. We need a balanced growth policy that will allow us to maintain the quality of life, yet sustain a reasonable tax base for our infrastructure requirements. And I will say District 2 South Forsyth is under tremendous pressure from special interests and these other developers and moneyed interests to grow faster than it is prudent. And I think a lot of counties have made a mistake by buckling under to that money. So we must resist the urge to grow for growth's sake. I stand for well-planned and quality growth in all cases. Traffic and congestion in some counties grew. They just went and said, okay, the more roads we build, just make them wider, longer, faster, put more red lights in and it'll fix itself. Well, we see where that's gotten us. Better traffic engineering that'll improve traffic flow without paving more of the surface area is the key. There's a lot of roundabouts are an excellent idea. They use them in Europe. You don't have to come to a complete stop and you yield. It's an excellent idea. And you know, look outside the zone there. It keeps balanced quality growth. It adheres to planning overlays and the UDC with minimal variances to existing buffer zones. And then water. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Derucki.
I have to stand up here. I might sweat all over this table before the evening.
I'm John Derucki. I'm running for County Commissioner in District 5. I had a prepared statement, but when you're talking about vision, I felt like it was better to come up here and speak to you from my heart. You know, I think we live in a wonderful county for a lot of different reasons. We have beautiful natural resources like Lake Lanier. We're at the foothills of the mountains, but at the same time, you know, we can get to a metropolitan area like Atlanta and enjoy restaurants and entertainment. Sporting events. We're close to transportation with Hartsfield-Jackson Airport. You can literally drive to some of the greatest places in very few hours, whether you want to get down into the Panhandle or in one of my favorite places to vacation is over in Charleston. There are a lot of things that drew myself and my family here. You know, particularly Lake Lanier was one of those. We've always lived near a lake. And when you have all of these beautiful natural resources like we have at our destination or at our disposal, plus you have a wonderful educational system, I can't think of a better place to live. And that has a lot to do with why I decided to run for county commissioner, because you know part of my vision is that I truly believe that we're at a crossroad. And we can either veer off into the wrong direction or we can veer off into the right direction. And if we're going to continue down the right path, then we have to learn how to handle all of this growth and balance it at the same time. You know, we have to maintain the quality and value in our homes. We need to promote and protect Lake Lanier, just as we will do with all of the natural resources that we have here. And, you know, for some of you that don't know me, yes, I've been in the construction business my entire life, and I can tell you one thing. I know the difference between good developments and I know the difference between bad developments. And I do see a lot of bad developments. I'm not saying that they're all bad, so please don't leave here tonight and misquote me and think that I said that, you know, Forsyth County has fallen apart, because that's not the truth. We do have some good developments here, but we also have some terrible developments here. And that's not a subject that I think that I need a lot of training on or a lot of speed to get hooked up to and moving in the right direction. You know, I own a small general contracting firm here in the county that I started in 2005. We're very focused on the kind of work we do. We love to concentrate on LEED projects, which is leadership in environmental and energy design. We don't do any kind of public work. at all. So, you know, I know not too long after my announcement and after SPLOS was passed, somehow I was awarded the jail and the courthouse without a public bid, but I'm here to put that rumor to bed. I can tell you, if I am elected county commissioner, we will never do a public job. Not as long as my name's on the sign. So, but what I see for us is creating a balanced growth. And that has everything to do with protecting natural resources and maintaining the value of your property. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Hart.
I didn't know the coffee was caffeinated. So if I start getting like this, know that I ain't used to caffeine. I drink decaf, so I'll be drinking coffee and chasing it with water to try to fizzle it down. But my name's Tim Hubbard, and I'm running for Commissioner Post 4, or District 4. I'm still used to the old way that we call them posts. Been here all my life. My family's grandparents, they was here. I've been very blessed to live in Forsyth County. And I count it on to be here. When folks ask, where are you from? I say, Forsyth County. And I'm proud to it. You know, a lot of folks have up and moved and went somewhere else because they didn't like Forsyth because of certain things that might have been. I love Forsyth. I know we have grown in population, but I remember as a child whenever we used to have to drive to Doraville to go eat out, go to Lionel Play World when I was a child. And I'm thankful that we have had some growth, but I believe in one of the things I believe we can still have growth and still have life as we've known it in the past, and it be not reckless. I know some things other counties have got reckless with their growth and trying to juggle it and dropping it. And I believe we can do this in a way that we can be balanced and be equal and still be able to have a good place to raise our children and grandchildren. And that's my vision. I didn't bring a statement. I'm the same way. I just speak from my heart because that's the way I am. My family, we started a business in, I didn't know it was that. Because I don't know the many. Thank you. But we started a business, my grandfather did, a trucking business in the early 40s. And we still do that today. My other grandfather, they was in the lumber business in the early teens. And they're still in business today. And we've been in construction all our life, and we also know how. I like to see things, a lot of things left alone, but I do know that we have to be able to grow, and in order for folks to come and want to live here, we need jobs for them, and that's something we need to work on. Oh, 3 seconds, 30. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm a little scattered from time to time, but I love Kent. And I don't want taxes to get out of hand. I'm afraid of that. I want things to stay balanced. And I want us to be able to reduce the budgets now and start now instead of waiting until we're in trouble. Right now, I don't believe we're in trouble. But if we continue the way that we're going, I believe we'll be in trouble in a few years. So, thank you very much.
Actually, I wanted to get up. I'm not fidgeting over here for there's gnats that are just driving me nuts over here. So, all right.
Sure, Bill.
I think city planning. All right. My name is Bill Mulrooney, and I'm actually going to try to answer the questions as opposed to talking too much about myself. I have a website, BillMulrooney.com. A lot of the things that, a lot of the issues I put on my website. For instance, my opinion on the Big Creek watershed, the whole thing that's on the web too. So if there's any questions you don't get answered tonight, BillMulrooney.com. All right, I define our county in several different ways. We're unique that the southern part of the county is more of a bedroom community. They're more dependent on Atlanta and outside the county. Then we have the city, which of course is a whole other topic. And anybody who's ever been shopping at the Publix at Hammond's Crossing on Memorial Day weekend knows that the vacation aspect of Forsyth County is very valuable to our economy. I live up that way, I live about a mile off the lake, and Saturdays in the summer is just crazy at the stores. But then also up in our district, in District 4, it's very rural, and we like that. My wife and I moved here back in 2000, we grew up in Snellville, and if anybody has seen Snellville lately, you know that's not the same as it was back in the 60s and 70s. And that's kind of one of the reasons we're here, because we wanted to move back to a place that was like Snellville used to be. I don't want to see Snellville in District 4. But the biggest problems I think that the county's facing in the future, the next 4 years, first off, jobs. We've got to quit defining jobs in this county as retail. Retail's great, but it's not a creator of growth, it's a byproduct of it. Nobody says, let's build a Walmart, people will move here. We need to attract real businesses offering real real businesses and attracting real employees. I've spent the last 25 years working with international manufacturers. This is kind of my niche. I know what these people look for. I know what they want. That's what we need to do. We need to get real companies here offering real jobs so that we all don't have to spend $4 a gallon and driving 100 miles round trip to get to work. Our budget-wise, another big thing facing the county is our budget. We've just passed this $200 million SPLOST. We now have to meet, 1 minute already? We now have to meet all those requirements, all those obligations that SPLOST has given us. We now have to meet those, and we have to be careful. We have to be smart, because we cannot do it by raising taxes. We're gonna build all these capital equipment projects, but then we're gonna have to fund it. Then we're gonna have to operate it. And we have to be really careful. We do not want we cannot raise taxes to do it. I also believe we need to be water independent. We need to be self-reliant. The county is the main water customer in this here, so we need to be self-reliant on water. District-wise, I think district reps spend, there's two jobs of the county commissioner. One is looking at the county as a whole, and the other is looking as a commissioner, representing the homeowners in my district. That's the important part, because too often we've been ignored. All right. 10 seconds, please. Anyway, the biggest problem with my district right now, we're gonna fix on July 31st. Thanks.
Sit the Nance back there, wait. I want to apologize. I usually try to fix up and look a little bit better, but I've been to the 4-hour commissioner's work session. 5 hour. And it was a rough one. A great American, John Wayne, said, and he even has it written on his tombstone, "Tomorrow is the most important thing in life. Comes into us at midnight, very clean. It's perfect when it arrives, and it puts itself in our hands. It hopes we've learned something from yesterday." My vision for the next 20 years for our county involves taking a look back at our past. Those things that were precious to my great-grandparents that lived here, our forefathers, should remain, and we should carry those qualities into our future, being good stewards of our land and our water while protecting our property rights, caring for those in need, surrounding our youth and our elderly with loving care that promotes education and healthy living, and pursuing a thriving economy. The county faces challenges economically in balancing its tax digest as property values decline, challenges with maintaining our quality of life with our parks, our roads, our libraries, and our public safety with lower tax revenues and escalating operating costs, and challenges that come with wanting to attract quality businesses while protecting our environment. I feel these challenges in our county are the same that's in our district, and a balance can be achieved with adequate planning, stellar leadership, and a community effort. Having a vision for the future, a vision of water independence, a vision for producing more jobs, a vision for a thriving Forsyth, are all the first steps in achieving our goal of a better Forsyth. We need to get back and look back at our forefathers and what they intended in having a government for the people that serves the people instead of serving itself. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
get bonus points. You only have 2 minutes.
I know, I should have taken up more time.
What time can you do this?
Can I have a little
while? I'd like to do a couple of raffle questions right now. Let's pull some numbers out here.
Did they buy those tickets?
Please answer that question.
This is for number
9197. I was just wondering if the county commissioners are going to allow overnight trips for the senior. They don't seem to have the funds to allocate trips for my friend here. He used to go on overnight trips with the senior center. And I was just wondering if they're going to ever do that again.
So for the candidates, would they support county funding to allow for seniors to do these overnight trips? And these are county facilities?
Yeah, senior center next to the library and all the other senior centers around town.
All right, let's just start on the right and work left.
I certainly think that we could look at it. I don't know, it would depend on the cost involved. I mean, if everybody pays their own way, you'd have to look at the liability issues, and y'all wouldn't get too wild. You'd have to sign a waiver, you know.
We've always done that.
But I think that it would be, I would be open to weighing it and seeing what could be done and to looking at all the possibilities that might be involved in it. I know banks used to take trips and let their seniors go on it, so I mean, I would be willing to look at it. I don't know anything about it, but I'm getting there quick. I turned 50 this year.
Let's just work.
Okay, I'm afraid I'm going to be real ignorant on this one. I'm not sure exactly. These would be funded, taxpayer-funded trips, overnight trips?
We use the bus.
Oh, okay.
My friend and I went on a really neat trip to Jacksonville and St. Augustine, and the county put it on, and we paid our own way and stayed overnight.
Do you live in there too?
Pardon me?
What district do you live in?
I don't know. I live on.
I was going to say that either Dennis or Brian could take y'all.
I've got plenty of time.
Dennis, how old is that car? We'll make it down there.
It'll make it.
Yeah. Let's give us a roll.
All right. You know, kind of like Cindy said, I'd be willing to, you know, if it doesn't come out of a taxpayer expense. I mean, it's not a leisure trip, but taxpayer expense. But what you're using is the county assets. You're using the buses. And actually, the buses are in large part state funded. They're given as grants to, you know, a lot of that money comes from the state fund. It comes as grants to the county. I would think that would be something to look at, again, as long as liability and as long as it's not, as long as we're not asking property owners to send you on a trip to Florida, then I wouldn't have a problem.
I don't see that there'd be a whole lot of problem with it, as long as y'all been funding yourself just using the bus and y'all are signing waivers, you know, for if anything was to happen. I don't know the reason why it stopped. I don't know that. Now, that would be something, I mean, I'm speaking that I don't know. I'd like to know why, and, you know, Brian, you probably know what might have come up, and I don't, as far as why they quit allowing them to go. And I'd say it was something to do with funding. I mean, right now is a rough economic time, and I understand why if they held out right now. But yeah, I don't see no harm in it, going by what y'all said that y'all have to do, and y'all provided your own money.
Okay.
I agree. You know, we've got to be a county of finding our way to yes. Do we have any attorneys in here?
Probably. I'm just starting to tell you.
Good.
No one will admit to it.
Because I'm not going to worry about everybody signing off on a waiver. I'm sure the county can find a way to get senior citizens on a trip that's self-funded, as long as you two promise you're not going out to Vegas. I'm sure we can make something happen.
I would say absolutely yes, if it doesn't violate either a state law, which I don't think it does, but I would say absolutely yes. Senior citizens are some of our most valued assets, and we all have a grandmother and a grandfather, and we love them dearly, and we'd like to see them enjoy those last days. Not saying anybody's close to your last days, but you want to see them get to go on the trips you want to go on. So I'd say absolutely yes. We would need to find a way to make that happen, Brian.
I'm glad you asked. I don't think there's a problem with that at all. In fact, as you know, which senior center do you go to?
Next to the library.
Oh, and you haven't been to the Cadillac down there in South Forsyth?
Yeah.
Have you been down there?
Yeah.
Do you like it?
Okay.
I don't see why not. We increased the funding slightly for Dollar Ride. Is that what you took? Was one of those buses down there before?
Yeah.
Or did you go to the casinos? Is that where you went? I don't see any problem with that at all. I'll be glad to check on it for you if you like. But, you know, to John's point about the waiver, you know, sometimes we do get carried away. We had a couple guys today that want a PTA to send a waiver so they can sell tomatoes on the side of the road. So we tend to sometimes over-govern a little bit too much. I don't know what happened to them. They have a budget. They don't itemize overnight trips in the budget. So that's an in-house decision. But we have the vehicles in the Dollar Ride. So I'll check on it for you if you like.
Yeah, let's do that.
This is last three digits, 923-349-923. Are you in the room and would you like to ask a question? 923.
I have
933.
No.
908-349-908.
No questions.
Last one. Last chance, and we're going on to the 149. I'm sorry, this is 350-149. 350-149. Are you in the room? Would you like to ask a question? Please do so. Introduce yourself, please.
I'm Rona Simmons from District 4. Hadn't thought ahead of time of questions, but I would like to ask, what is the remuneration for a county commissioner, and what percentage of that of your own income would that remuneration amount to for you?
Okay, so what's the annual salary, and what would that of your annual salary, what would that, what percentage, I guess?
That's pretty personal.
You want to start from how much do you get paid, and how much as a county commissioner? How much of that is a total of your income?
Yeah, they changed it a couple years to make it a lot simpler. We used to get a monthly allowance plus a small salary. Now it's $35,000 a year, give or take a few hundred dollars. And there are, I mean, if you go far out of town, you can turn in an expense account, I guess. I've been on the job 8 years. I've never turned in an expense account for any of my in-county business. So you're going to pay for some of that yourself, your own gas and mileage. So, and there are county cars available. If you like them, go at your own risk.
Of your annual income, that is a large part, small part. I don't think we should ask people percentages, but.
It's nobody's business.
I think it just kind of depends on the day in my business. It really does.
Yeah, the restaurant.
I don't have a salary with what I do for a living.
Let me ask the candidates, how many are retired? Okay. How many are actively?
My wife says I'm retired.
How many are actively employed right now? Okay, and of those, how many are in the county?
Well,
That's good information. Does anybody else want to answer her question specifically?
I do. Because I've thought a lot about your question. I mean, just to be honest, I thought when I got into the race that the pay was still $17,000. I didn't realize that it went up because I'm not doing it for the money. And not that I am filthy rich, but I do fine. I don't need the money in it. And I debated all through the years. I've heard this debate since I've been a part of government that we need to raise the amount commissioners get paid because we get a better quality of person. And from my watching this and looking back at my little speech about our forefathers, I think we've gotten away from doing it for the right reasons and doing it because you love and you care about your county. I know it takes a lot of hours, and I know if I can be elected, I'd be just one vote out of five. But I have my own health insurance. I have my own cell phone. I have my own car. I'm going to have to pay for all those things, whether I'm a commissioner or not, so I'm not looking to get the freebie to go with it. I don't need a vendor to help me buy my tires or to change my oil because I'm doing that anyway. I personally would vote to take it back to $17,000, and I know you think I'm pandering for votes, but I don't care about that because I've seen in District 4, you get representation sometimes of people that don't have a job, and that's the last thing you want in office. The last thing you want is a needy commissioner to walk in. That $34,000 or $35,000 is a good salary, especially if you're getting all the fringe benefits that come with it. Those are not the kind of people that benefit the citizens of Forsyth County, and they're not what you want in office.
Do you mean the House doesn't come with it?
No, the House doesn't.
Anyone else?
Yeah, just quickly, I get a good Army retirement, for example. Commissions, I thought it paid a lot less than that when I signed on to it. So the only reason I'm not working is because I am running for this job. But win or lose, I'm going to be Susie's not going to let me sit home, so.
Just to clarify what I said earlier, we used to get paid by the meeting. Mm-hmm. And then somewhere along the way, people started contesting what exactly is a meeting. You know, is this a meeting? Was it a meeting when I walked out, you know, when I came up and somebody said hello to me? I mean, what is a meeting? So I think it was 2006 or 7, I don't know, where they just decided to make it all taxable income because the meetings weren't taxed. So they were an allowance. You got a maximum of up to 20 meetings a month, I think, or something. So I think it's a little less than $35,000 a year, like 33. I don't really know, to be honest with you.
I'd like to answer.
Sure.
Can I answer your question? In my case, I'm like Cindy. I actually believe the Founding Fathers had the right idea. This is supposed to be a citizen representation. We're supposed to have good people step up, serve their time, and then step back and let somebody else do it. As we've been going through this process, I've realized that people expect us all to be crooks. I mean, I've had people just, oh yeah, run for office, you must be a crook. And if we keep accepting that, we're never going to change. In my case, I spent years on the road. It used to be literally my job was I'd drive to the airport on Monday and I'd get home on Friday night. I got off the road and my wife and I started our own little business. We're quite successful with it. We also run a nonprofit. She works part-time, and what we're going to end up doing if I win is we're going to swap some things around. Basically, my volunteer time is what's going to be given up for this. Because to me, this is just another extension of community service. So she's going to pick up a little bit more of the business aspect of it, of the business we're running. We're starting to hire people to be able to do some of the monkey work anyway. So we've got a plan as far as how to manage the time. No, we're not doing it for the money.
Yeah, I'd like to add to it. It's probably from a different perspective. I know Brian and some other folks up here also own their own businesses. And we're all probably set up a little bit differently. You know, when I set up my business, I didn't set it up to be a family business like a lot of contractors do. I have two daughters. Not that there's anything wrong with them taking the business over. One of them, in fact, is a civil engineer. But that's not the way I set my business up. I set it up so that the young guys that are coming up behind me and investing their time and effort ultimately get to either be given that business because the business wouldn't survive without them, or they can buy portions of it or whatever. I have a 10% owner. One of those young guys has earned 10% of the company. And so if I'm elected and I take on the salary of a county commissioner, then having a 10% partner would not be fair for me to double dip salary. And particularly if I'm stepping away and he's taking on more responsibility, it'll work the other way. My salary at the office will drop, and then his will increase because his responsibilities increase. So it's a little bit different for everybody and how they want to do it. At least that's my perspective. I do agree with what they're saying, though. If you're running for this office and that's somehow tied to money, you must be absolutely crazy. That's the only thing I can figure.
I mean, can tell you it was $14,000 a year when I was first elected.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
Plus some meetings.
Okay. Jim? Well, when we had to pay our qualification fees, I found out how much it did pay. I was unaware that it was that much, but when my daddy was in office, it was $18 to qualify. They got a $100 a month is what they got to run. And then when they had to go to extra meetings, I think it paid them $20 more. So he got rich. I'm as Cindy and well as you as well. I have my own business. I have my own vehicles. I have my own health insurance. I mean, I'm not running for anything other than to represent the people of District 4 and to be a mouthpiece for them and to be there when they need to talk to somebody, not to brush them off. I won't talk to them. Come see me or I'll come see you. I mean, that's the way I want to be personal about the commissioner office. If I'm elected, I won't see you. I don't want to see you over email. I want to talk to you face to face. That's the way I believe things ought to be done. I realize we got high tech. I've done had a bunch of things. You're going to have to get high tech. I realize that. But I still want a personal relationship with people. That's just how I feel about that. And as far as what I make a year, well, I don't make as much now as I did back in 05, 06, and 07, and then the bottom fell out, but I'm still keeping my head above water. And that's all, you know, I've tried to do, is just get by just like so many of people in the county. We're just getting by. We've had to reduce our budgets to get by, and that's why I think, you know, the county needs to reduce it, just like we have.
Thank you, everyone, for those answers.
All right, the next question is a smart growth question and it deals with the Big Creek watershed. The Big Creek watershed has been portrayed as a District 2 kind of an issue. But the fact remains that the Big Creek watershed contains about 33% of the buildable land left in the county, the developable land left. And so it is a difficult topic. Because the Big Creek watershed currently has a potential restriction on it levied by the state, which says that you cannot build more than 25% impervious surface in the entire watershed. The county has interpreted that up until this point in a way that does not apply that to specific parcels. If you want to build a house, they're not going to come and say you can only have 25%. But what they will do is take the percentage of your development and add it, presumably, to the larger calculation for all of the impervious surface within the Forsyth County portion of the watershed. It's a political hot topic because the watershed extends across multiple counties and actually multiple municipalities. And so there's a lot of finger pointing that goes on that says, well, you know, Fulton County, they're at 45%, and the city of Cumming is at 57%. You know, why are we, Forsyth County, unincorporated portion of Forsyth County, why do we have to pay attention to the 25% impervious surface limitation when nobody else has to? It's a good question. It's a fair question. And there's also a question of, well, let's assume for a second that the county enforce the letter of the law. And I wanted to build a house or I wanted to develop a shopping center and we're already at 25%. Now you're going to tell me I can't?
Well, is that a taking now? Have you taken from me for my ability to get the best and most profitable use out of the land that I own? And so the county hasn't grappled with that issue yet. So the question, and this is a countywide question, and so I'd like to start with Mr. Hubbard and work down, and then we'll go to John and work down. The question for you is, what are your thoughts on the Big Creek watershed? Should the county enforce a 25% limitation? If not, should it be a different number, 35, 45? Should the county take the state to court and try to get the law changed? Or if you are for it, or you do believe that impervious surface should be limited and that it is a vital resource, then how are you going to compensate people who can't do what they want to do at some point in the future? What's your approach to management? So fairly involved. I'm going to be kind of liberal here. I'm going to set it at about three minutes. We'll just play it by ear and see how we go. Because this is a difficult question, and you know, it's a train that's coming down the tracks. You can see the light, it's coming, and it's going to hit us. And so we need to figure out how we're going to deal with it. So
right now it's 25%, correct?
It is. What is the current percentage? Well, the county will tell you that the current percentage is, 11%? 11 or 12%? That's the GIS department has determined the existing percentage. What they have not done is include that portion of things that have been approved to be built, but haven't been built yet. So our estimation, Smart Growth's estimation, is in reality, you're closer to 20% right now. Yeah, we think it's about 20%.
How long has it been since they've done a survey for?
The county did a survey in 2009.
Okay. I was just wanting to make sure it's been something recent instead of 10, 15, 20 years old. I realize when you're around Big Creek, a lot of the land is in a floodplain. A lot of it is. I've been here for a long time, and it comes hard rains, we see evidence of that. Floods out. But as far as the state requiring a certain percentage, I don't see what would be, if we do a whole lot, we're going to have to go and argue with the state on this. But it needs to stay within a reasonable amount. It don't need to go away because we need the area for when heavy rains do come, a place for the water to go. And most people that already have real estate in this area already know that they're limited to what they can do with the property. And my thinking's on that, if you buy something like that, you already know that you can't use a certain percent of your property. But as far as the county reimbursing somebody, I don't see why the county should reimburse someone for real estate that you bought knowing that it's in a floodplain. That's sort of how I feel about that. Now that may not jihad with a lot of people, but if you go buy land that's in a floodplain, there ain't a whole lot of development going to be going on it that's going to be within reason. I think we ought to, leave it close to where it's at. There's no reason to change it.
Mr. Miller?
I said 20%, 25. I know you said 11. Sorry about that. Wanted to clarify.
No problem. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out if you pave over your water tailing, you're going to have a problem. I mean, that's just common sense.
Yeah.
And you hear people screaming, it's always Agenda 21, and it always reminds me of the old Joan Baez song.
Which is?
Pave paradise and put up a parking lot.
Joni Mitchell,
thank you. Not Joni Mitchell. Joni Mitchell. Okay, anyway, so thank you. So here's the problem with this thing, and as you said, nobody really knows the answer. I mean, they say the watershed is 99 square miles covering 5 or 6 municipalities, and some people say as a whole, we're already at 25%, where the county says we're at 11 or 12% for the county, but how can we control what goes on at Roswell? This is a state mandate that I really don't see a solution to. I think it's a state problem. I think we need to kick it back up to the state and say this is not, you know, we can't live with this. Because what's happened is everybody else has built up, and now they're looking at Forsyth County property owners to be the ones left holding the bag. We're the guys who are now stuck with the limitations. And 25%, if you figure out, just look at your house, your driveway and your porch and your patio and your sidewalks, 25% is not a whole lot of space on a, you know, on an acre of land. So I believe it's a state problem. We need to kick it back up to whoever wins the July 31st primary there and tell them that, and deal with the EPD at that level and tell them we can't work it, find a solution. In the meantime, I think we can start recording future developments, to add an extra box to all proposals as to how much impervious services are going to be, try to have better records, try and get a better base standard for what we're dealing with. But I really don't see, there's, you know, paying people not to use the property is ludicrous. It's not ludicrous, it's just, how would we do that? Who wants to raise the property taxes so somebody else can build a shopping mall or doesn't build a shopping mall? It's just not a workable solution. It's gotta go back to the state.
I'm done. I went to the town hall meeting that they had on this topic and found it very informative, and I appreciated both sides, and I like to pride myself on being able to listen to both sides. I do understand that water sources it's essential to our ecosystem and that it's a very important topic, but I'm a very big proponent of property owner rights as well. And I will never stand before any group and say that I think a taking of any kind is what any of our forefathers had in mind. I think every one of our homes are our asset, and it's something that we should take great pride in and be very proud that we have that. Now, that doesn't mean that I think everybody should be able to do whatever they want to, but I do believe that there's limits. I think we have to discover what is the problem. If the problem is the quality of the water, then I think we need to look at solutions. There is so many more viable, and Alan Neal can answer this better than me, but there's so many viable solutions to water that did not exist when they came up with this 25% rule. We can do so many things now. I mean, in that meeting that night, a big thing that was pointed out was that in our creeks, failing septic tanks was having as great a problem as impervious surface, is what one side was arguing. So especially up in our district, in District 4, we have a lot of people talk about failing septic tanks on the lake. So if we can figure out what are we really getting at? Is it really our motive to stop all growth? Or is really our motive to try to have our water is what's crucial and it's vital in improving our water? Then we can, if we identify what the problem is, then we can go find some real viable solutions to the problem.
Okay. Well, I from my perspective, I think it's everybody's responsibility to do everything that they possibly can to protect all the watersheds, whether it's the Etowah, the Chattahoochee, or Big Creek. The thing that I find fascinating that I did not learn until I went to the town hall meeting was the fact that there's such a difference between what maybe a group like Smart Growth thinks the percentage is and what the county thinks the percentage is. You know, that technology is available to us today. It depends on, you know, coming up with a baseline and saying, hey, we all need to agree. All of the stakeholders need to agree how to assess where are we at in the overall percentage. That's step number one. Step number two is the data is available to monitor either proposed, projected, or nearly completed projects. Every project that gets submitted for a building permit has that data available to it. It's part of the civil engineer's submittal package to get that permit. So that's the easy part. Now the hard part is that when you talk about limiting it to 25%, the end game is protecting the quality of the water. Again, I don't care what watershed it's in. I believe that there are best management practices out there that you can use. The UDC does limit you to the 25%, but it also allows you to use an alternate to come up with the best management practices. And that's different on every piece of property. You know, the 25% rule might apply as a number, but based on the slope of the property, the soil type, the vegetation, and the wildlife, it may not be of benefit to that piece of property. You may have to reduce the percentage, and that property may become unbuildable.
That's a fact. What I would like to see is that that's disclosed before somebody buys it. Trust me, in my business, I see a lot of people go out there and buy cheap pieces of property thinking that they got a deal, they're going to build on it, and at the end of the day, they can't build on it because the techniques that you would have to do to build there are so expensive, it makes it prohibitive. So the good deal died on the vine. So there, it's a complex issue. It's one that we have the ability to solve. It's one that we have the ability to manage. But at the end of the day, it's all about maintaining or improving the quality of water. And again, from my perspective, that's not limited to just the Big Creek. It includes the Etowah and it includes the Chattahoochee.
Yes? First of all, the watershed is absolutely a critical county resource. I mean, you know, once that wildlife and things that are in there, those habitats, once they're destroyed, you're never going to get them back, or it'd take hundreds of years, literally. So you can go and ask some of these counties that have already overbuilt about property values and density, and that's what it really ties to. I want to sell my property for the maximum amount, okay? The first few get to do that, but down the road, as we overbuild things and build more and more high density, we become more and more like DeKalb County, Gwinnett County, and these other counties that everybody's busting the door down to get to Forsyth County because it's different. So we've got to do something different or we're going to get the same result. And so the first thing we've got to do is measure it. I can't believe what the county's not already measuring this in a very quantitative way, and so we know exactly how much impervious surface is there. We think it's 11, but they think it's closer to 20. We should know exactly how much it is so we could manage it. And then some of these areas that are sitting vacant for all these years that are paved and paved, why don't we reclaim some of that before we just cut down more trees and repave something else? If they did that in New York City, look how that place would, you know, reclaim some of these areas that are already paved and put it back into good productive use so it will absorb that water instead of running off with the extra pollution into our streams. To me, it's very simple. It's a state law we need to abide by. If it's 25%, we need to start measuring it. We need to start abiding by it. And if it's too high or too low, then we need to get the legislators involved and change it. But, you know, just ignoring it and saying it's pointing our fingers somewhere else is not going to make it go away. And you can ask all those people that live in other parts of the state, you know, do we want to... There's a reason they're moving to Forsyth County in droves, and there's a reason the quality of life is here. It's because we made different decisions that are not the norm that you're seeing down there, okay? So that's why Forsyth County is special, and we need to address it and not run away from it.
Right. Well, two things. First of all, you're right, it's not going away. It's something that has to be addressed. Second of all, there's been a lot of good answers to it. The county took a big step, though, in with his Parks, Recreation, and Green Space model, just buying some land. Nothing better than that. However, we can't buy it. The county can't buy the county. So, but we can make improvements. I mean, if you think back to 2008 when there was a drought, who would have thought we could have cut our water usage by 10%? But we did. Every house that was built just about 2006, 2007 had an irrigation system. If it was over 2,500, 3,000 square feet, it had an irrigation system. As we continue to sewer the county and use less septic systems, we are much, much better off. Much, much better off. You know, we've talked about this before and I remain committed. I think we need to fund a working model. I think, as John said, bring the stakeholders together, decide what we're going to do about it. I mean, it doesn't have to be just a countywide moratorium. You know, there's different surfaces we can use. We can use impervious surfaces in places that we're using impervious surfaces now. I mean, use impervious surfaces where we're using impervious surfaces now. So I don't know if that's just a basic summary of what everyone else said, but
okay.
a working model, I think, is in order.
All right, thank you. Let's start, go back to the raffle now.
Yep, we'll go back to audience questions. And then we have number 349927. In the room, would you like to ask a question? 349927, going once, going twice.
Bingo. Please stand. You are.
My name is Krista Morrissey. I live down to District 2. My question is in general about bringing business into the county to help bring tax revenue. What would you do to attract business? And would you use either tax dollars or funds? How would you fund that process to bring business into the county to help support the tax digest?
What I'd like to suggest is, can we hold your question for a moment? If it's okay with the audience, this is really your call. We'd like to give Ms. Chairman Boff an opportunity to give an opening statement since he's coming in late. Is that okay with everyone?
Sure.
Good? Okay, so Jim, what we did in the beginning, the first three questions that had been sent to the candidates were you were to describe your vision in 250 words or less for the next 20 years, was combined with identifying what you think the top three challenges are both to your district and the county. So if you could try to put that together in about 3 minutes worth of time, which is what everyone else had, you get a chance for an opening statement. If you want to step up front, you can, if you're more comfortable. He is artistic direction here, so.
I know what happened last time. Somebody didn't do what she wanted. thank you very much. I'm sorry I was not here. I just came back from an executive session. And commissioner meeting right before that. Yeah, vision for 20 years. I don't have a 20-year vision, I'll be honest with you. My vision goes out maybe 10 years. I believe the county is already positioned very well, and it's now it's time to take advantage of and to pay off some of the nice things that we have come to have in the recent years. We're going to have enough trouble, I believe, paying for the operations of some of those nice things. And I also believe that the global economy especially is in such an unknown state at this point that any additional major expenditures that are not already pretty well known, whether you like them or not, by people, it's not a good time to entertain things like that. I believe that we should pay down debt where we can, consider collecting fees, perhaps new ones for usage of some of these things if we can and it's acceptable to the citizens, and just in general enjoy and hope that some of these things do in fact attract people who would like to pay some of our SPLOST tax for us. So my vision is essentially to continue with what we have. In terms of some of the other things, the major problems, first of all, by and large, I ran the first time under the assumption or the premise that we didn't have a lot of major problems, and I still believe that. I'm not to say we don't have problems, but the finances are pretty good in the county. We have plenty of green space. We have plenty of the things we need. We're taking care as best we can of our children. We've got several unique and good approaches. We have the Boys Lodge, we have SAFT, we have Jesse's House, we have CASA, and we contribute a good deal of money and spend a good deal of time trying to make sure that the organizations that we support buttress the justice system, because we're guided by Judge Jackson a lot on that, which then keep court costs down or other kinds of costs down. So the issues, though, to me, continue to be water, where to get more of it, because even with the new contract, we're going to need more water. They continue to be transportation, and they continue to be conformance to the UDC, because I personally believe that we got into this pretty good shape that we're in for a number of reasons, but not least of which is that by sticking largely to the standards that we have for what we expect of developers and builders to come here has caused this county to grow and also caused it to be still a desirable place where builders are still coming, where they aren't coming to a lot of other counties in order to build new houses or take over some of the green pipe farms. And that's it.
Thanks. Okay. You want to say your question again? It was what?
What would you do to attract businesses into the county, and would you use taxpayer funds to do so? Or how would you do it
I think the biggest thing we can do to attract new businesses is to set a climate that is attractive for businesses and get a reputation for attracting business and being business friendly, while at the same time balancing our growth to maintain the homeowner values. Example I use is Silicon Valley. You have to have a really educated workforce. You have to have world-class schools. That's one of the top things that, you know, if an employer, a Fortune 500 company decides to relocate to Forsyth County, they're gonna look at the school system and they're gonna look at the quality of life, because where their kid's gonna grow up, that's probably the number one factor they're gonna look at. Of course, they gotta have people that are educated enough to do the businesses. So one of my friends says, lives in Forsyth County, and says, well, why don't we have a place here where I can open a business? There's not an office park large enough that I can do my business here. So I have to, you see all these people every morning going down 400. One of the reasons we need to keep widening 400 is that we don't have enough of the quality type jobs that we need here in Forsyth County. And I think that's the biggest thing to do it. I would not use taxpayer money to do that. I don't think you need to do tax incentives. If you have a good quality base and a good quality climate where businesses want to come here anyway, you don't have to lure them with tax incentives. You do that where to places where the schools aren't so good and things. If you have the proper schools and the workforce, they'll come here without any tax incentives.
So we didn't like the question. Because this is one that's near and dear to my heart. You're absolutely right. Educated workforce, that is the number one thing companies look for, and we actually have some advantages there. We have we have technical schools. We have a new college opening up. This is something we can take advantage of. Companies are moving home. All these businesses that moved out to China, they're moving home. Labor rates in China have gone up 15%. Fuel prices have skyrocketed, increasing transportation costs. Our natural gas costs here in this country are lower than anywhere else in the world. And companies are realizing that, you know, having engineering 10,000 miles away from manufacturing comes with a high cost. So there are companies that are moving home that want to come back. We need to open the door for them. We need to make sure that we're the place they want to come to. I would start by eliminating the inventory tax on products. I mean, if you want to have somebody come in here and put a lot of hardware in here, store, you know, manufacturing, distribution centers, that kind of place, they put a lot of money on the shelves. Don't make them pay inventory tax on that. That's number one. If we defeat T-SPLOS, we'll be at a 7% sales tax. That'll be pretty good. The Chamber of Commerce, this building right here. I love the goals, hate the politics. The county gives this group money every year. We need to set definable goals for them, and we need to then measure those goals at the end of the year. If they don't meet the goals, they don't get the money the next year. We need to put some of the responsibility back across the street at the county admin building. We need a business development management team over there that says, this is what we want to do, this is how we're going to get there. Chamber of Commerce, you want money, this is the goals you're going to need to get there. And then we need to measure what we're doing. And you know what? 75% of the top 1,000 companies in the world have representation in Atlanta. And Mr. Tam, I'll take one of those old Forsyth County cars and I'll drive downtown and call on these folks. I mean, we need to get people excited. We need to do what it takes to get into these businesses. Let them know that we're open for business up here, because God knows we need to quit. We need to quit driving to work. We need to work here.
Yep. My turn. Your turn. This is something that I feel very passionate about, and I am looking eagerly for solutions, because I do think we have a lot of the factors that are conducive to attracting great businesses here. And I understand that we desperately need to balance our tax base, because we don't want to be just a bedroom community, because essentially that means we'll all just have to pay a whole bunch in taxes. But I think it's important what we go after and the businesses that we go after. I went a couple of months ago and sat down with Tom Brown, our planning director, and I said, Tom, what do you think, or what's our big problem that we're not attracting business other than the bad economy? And we were talking about the UDC, and we were laughing about how now in the UDC you have to have 10 sets of plans, and even when the fire marshal doesn't have to sign off, you still have to get in your car and drive up to Sitting Down Road to get the fire marshal to sign a set of plans to say he doesn't have to sign off on it. And it's insane, but that's the way bureaucracy does. And I said, well, why can't we fix that? Why can't we look at the UDC and streamline it and make it better, make it more efficient, make it work for the people, and make it work for business? And he said, well, we have attempted to do that, but we're spending a lot of our time. We're making so many changes to the alcohol ordinance and the sign ordinance, random changes, that it's taking one person in my office to deal with those changes all the time. And I'm like, well, then why can't we make it where we only do changes to the alcohol ordinance three times a year, or whatever works? What would be more functional for you? That you could have a staff person that would free that up. And Tom was like, that's a great idea. That would help, and then it would free up. So I think that there's so many things that we can do. I'm working on a model right now that is called Fast Track Forsyth, and I'm hoping to figure out a way, which, you know, ideas are good ideas, and sometimes they're not functional once you get in there, but I would love to see us be able to streamline and bring businesses in and assign somebody to work with that business and help walk them through the process, and it not be so onerous that we drive people away, but we embrace them and we welcome them here.
Okay.
John?
Some of this I can agree with, some of it I can't agree with. You know, one of the hard things I had to do today was I said this earlier, I have a daughter who's a civil engineer, and I had to say goodbye to her. She got on a plane to go to Shanghai because they were willing to invest in a $70 million plant there and not here. I can tell you that the way that the economy has been going, a lot of the people that I have come through the business with ever since I got out of school, most of those people are working overseas because that's where the development's going. So I understand what Bill's saying, but I don't see that from my perspective. I still see employers wanting to flood outside of this country. The other advantage I have in what I do for a living is I get to meet with a lot of different business owners. They do all kinds of different things, from you know, consulting firms to tanning salons to fitness studios to retail centers, over and over. And part of the reason why I decided to run for this office was because through all of that and the conversation and the startup of their business and why are they doing that, why did you pick this location or why did you pick that location, and oh, by the way, why wouldn't you want to bring this business to Forsyth County? I resoundingly got the same answer over and over and over again. And that was, I would never think about going there because those people are crazy. But what are they talking about when they say that those people are crazy? I'm not talking about any one individual commissioner. What I'm talking about is a government that puts up more barriers to business than we do with opening those gates. We have to learn to do that differently. I work in a lot of different municipalities. I see a lot of different things, a lot of things that are very efficient. I worked with a bunch of businessmen a year and a half ago. We presented 38 items to the county to improve efficiency. I'm not talking about opening the floodgates. To this day, I don't think that maybe more than two or three of those items have ever been accepted and incorporated. We've got to get beyond the no and get to the yes. And do that in balance.
Jim?
I personally don't buy that people are going to Shanghai because things are tough on people here. I also think that what you should do is to call James McCoy every day and ask what he's done for you lately, because he does a good job. I also think, thank you, I'm not talking long enough. I also think that we have a development authority which has set out to bring businesses here. They don't have, so far, a great track record, but who does in this economy? But they are working on it a lot and all the time. I would certainly hope that people who live in Fulton County, and listen to me carefully, please, I would hope that the people who live in Fulton County vote for their T-SPLOST, because they pay for it and it helps us. We are dependent a lot on what happens to Atlanta. We are dependent, and Atlanta is almost entirely dependent on what happens to the Atlanta airport, for which we now have a whole new international concourse / terminal. How many people knew that? I'm just curious.
I did.
Okay. Well, I have high hopes for that. I went on a tour of it. It was before it was open. It's wonderful. I don't think that, again, we're perfect, but Taubman, how many people know who Taubman is? The development that's supposed to go in, that is projected to bring in around $10 million in tax and other revenues a year when it's fully built. They have already decided to come here a few years ago, had nothing to do with me, but the national economy, the global economy, has kept retailers from being able to commit to them so that they can come here. Again, I don't want to propose that everything is perfect here in the county, but we have, for everybody who's been disappointed by something that's happened here, we've had a lot of people who have come here, a lot of people who like it here, and a lot of people who will come here, who are actually in the process of breaking ground already, but not fully, as soon as the economy catches up.
Ted? Okay. I was being patient. Red tape. A good bit of red tape is keeping a lot of folks from being here. Not a lot, just enough to aggravate and pull them away. The inventory tax, that's another key thing, I believe, that would help, as Bill's already said, would help draw businesses here, help them stock and hire people to work there. Like I said, in the whole beginning of us announcing we was running, if we begin to cut the budget, just, you know, a little at a time, because it got to this point over time, so we can't just do away with it. We're just going to have to go slow. And if we begin to go slowly at cutting the budget, we'll be able to, as far as the inventory tax that we'll lose, we won't really be noticing it, because it'll all balance out the first year. That's what I believe. Now, I don't know that that's something that everybody agrees with, but I think that's one way to draw companies to South County. I know it would help with a lot of folks that I know as far as putting their company here. They ain't having to pay a lot of money on their inventory. That's kind of aggravating at the end of the year, having to go add everything up, then cough up a big amount of money at the end of the year, thinking that you've profited that year, then going up. Forget about that. And that's what's happened to a lot of folks. So I believe that would draw a lot of companies here and streamline, do away with some of the red tape, not get it to where anybody can come here and not have a set of guidelines. That ain't what I'm saying. I'm just saying relax some things a little bit, but make sure, in the same sentence, make sure that they're confiding in doing exactly what we believe needs to be done, but without, you know, trying to choke them as well. And it can be done. I believe that.
Right? Me? Thank you. First of all, before I was a commissioner, I sat on the board of directors for the Chamber of Commerce, and I have a lot of confidence in them and what they've been able to accomplish. I don't think we need economic development in the administration building. I don't think it needs to be tied to any politicians whatsoever, because then you get people with personal agendas. And we, frankly, we've tried that. I watched it. And it just doesn't work. It needs to be out of there. So I think they have a vice president of economic, well, I know they have a vice president of economic development here with the chamber, and I think he does a great job. one of the reasons that, you know, we have to change the sign ordinance, we have to change the alcohol ordinance, is because we don't allow for a variance to those ordinances. We had one we talked about today, very nice lady, has a great business plan, wants to go into the avenue and have a wine and cheese shop. But she wants people to be able to taste the wine. That's against the law. So it does take time. If you're going to change an ordinance, you have to have two public hearings. It takes 2 months. So we're going to have a public hearing, let the public come speak and decide if we're going to change the alcohol ordinance so this young lady can go forward with her business plan and let people taste wine in there. Now I think, and this is just a small shop, you know, she's going to have her own private room, like say in the back, where they're going to be able to taste. I think if you let her do that, she will have more of a selection of wine. Her wine sales will probably go up, because being in the business, people are 7 times more likely to try wine in a restaurant than they are to buy it at a store, because you can't taste it at a store. Whereas in a restaurant, you can get a glass of it, decide if you like it. Otherwise, you've got 20, 30 bucks invested in a bottle of wine you don't like. So, with respect to business and attracting business to the county, we need to be, I think, selective, i.e. the avenue. That could have been 2 or 3 strip malls. It could have been. And if you don't know, it came to Forsyth County on a 3-2 vote. 2 of the commissioners voted against it. We did do some investments because we changed our sewer plan to run sewer underneath Georgia 400 to accommodate them and the land where the Children's Self-Care of Atlanta is. That was not unanimous by the Board of Commissioners. But it has paid itself back many times over. It was an investment. So, but we invested in Ronald Reagan in 141, we prioritized that section get done first. So we were going to do it anyway, but let's prioritize it, that gets that done first. And we got with the DOT and said, look, you're going to start widening 141, you need to start up here by the avenues, because that's going to put money back in our pocket, sales tax wise, if we can get people able to shop at the avenue even faster. So I guess the short answer is we do what's prudent and we do what we're going to get a return on investment on. We don't pay people to come here. We don't have to, because we have great amenities. And when they come here, they have to adhere to our standards. New York Life is a great example. I mean, that's an environmentally friendly company that has 6-figure a year paying jobs. Great company for us. Do I have to stop or tell me? I'm not ready.
No,
sorry.
I think
1 minute.
No, it's about 5. 15 minutes is up, right?
You can finish with the same.
I would just like to point out a couple of things. You know, we're going to have about 1,500 building permits this year, which is many more than our neighbors. I'd like to see them use up the existing inventory, and a lot of them are using up the existing inventory, as opposed to zoning more property, which is speaks to the Big Creek watershed. So we're constantly under pressure to allow them to build smaller houses, more density. Hey, I'll take that off your hand if you let me do this. And we haven't done that. As a board, we've stood firm and said, no, if you're going to build here, you're going to build here right. Your density is going to be comparable to what's next to you, and the quality of the house is going to be comparable to what's next to you. Now, some people go other places, okay? But our property values stay high. We're looking at a tax digest that's going to decline by probably less than 1%. Go ask them that question in Clayton County or DeKalb County about what is happening to their tax digest. And look what's happening here and why the Board of Commissioners isn't going to raise your property taxes, isn't going to raise your millage rate. Because of
Oh, now back to her question, which is what you're going to do about business.
I think I said that.
We're good.
Let's go. Will the judges take that?
One more?
Of course.
350155. Are you in the room and would like to ask a question? 155.
Thank you.
Well, I'm gonna call an audible here. Go ahead, ask your question, because you're dying to ask this question.
I'm 152, but I'll take it anyway. I'm Sherry Gilligan. I live in a district where we're not even voting, but I'm always interested in what's going on. And some of the things that bother me that goes on or has in the past, and you'll see it, tons of buildings got built and they stayed empty. Lots of land got stripped and they remained empty. And I keep thinking, if they had to present a business plan, just like when you start a brand new business and you want to get a loan, and your business plan has to be there, and you have to say how many people are going to be in your building. Why do we not have something like that? Can we have something like that? Or how would you, if you were on the board, and we're talking about growth growing in the next couple of years, how will you make sure that we don't have dead buildings and dead land with nothing going on there?
Let's go with John first.
Lucky day.
Take it.
Let me help you out for a little bit, because there is a process. There is a process at the county for development to come forward with a plan. Now, as many folks have already pointed out, it's fraught with its own version of red tape. And I will give you a concrete example from the smart growth perspective. If you look in the UDC, and please understand if you're here, that governance is not just about the broad outlines of vision statements, but it's also understanding the mechanics, the hard level detail that's inside a unified development code, and being able to say in paragraph 18.2-6.4, it says you must do the following. You have to know that if you're a commissioner. And the point I'm getting at is that there's a process called a site sketch plat. And in the sketch plat, there's language that says that developers shall do X, Y, and Z. And in legal terms, anytime you use the word shall, it's instructive to the person who's submitting something. And technically, the development community will tell you that they will not do what's required in the sketch plat because it costs too much money up front. It's hundreds of thousands of development dollars that technically would go in for a sketch plat to do very much what you're talking about today. So there are processes there. How they're being executed at the county level is a matter of great debate. So now, with that, I gave you some cover.
I think the heart of your question is how do you prevent the dead business? It just happens to be in the building on that corner. And you know, I don't know that there's much that a county commissioner can do to start interjecting themselves in that process of deciding what is a viable business and what's not a viable business. Because that's either thumbs up, you live, thumbs down, you die. And I don't see that as the role of the commissioner. I do see the role of the commissioner enforcing the UDC. It's a living, breathing document. It gets amended from time to time. It's not perfect. It needs to be reviewed and updated often. The problem with the dead buildings, and I see a lot of them, and again, that's not the type of work that we do, but the developers, you have to understand, were under the mentality of build it and they will come. Well, that didn't work that didn't work well. And they're finding it out now. A lot of them have died on the vine and are no longer around. Trust me, it was a painful process for them and for those of us that built for them. It's unfortunate. Those things happen. I think it's sad. I mean, I drive up and down 141 going home to my office every day, and I find it, quite honestly, as disgusting as you do and a lot of other people do.
You know, and they can, those dead buildings can appear and be in full compliance with UDC. You know, I mean, that's the reality of that's a sad part. You know, banks aren't doing that anymore. So hopefully that process, as it's tightened up, is going to be vetted out now. I see a lot of restrictions put on banks, on developers now, by the banks. And I think to a degree that's a good process. Money is very, very tight out there. And that is going to be interesting as we go further down the road, because they are going to want concessions, because they can't afford to do what they were doing a few years ago. And that's where we have to, you know, be steadfast. But at the same time, we have to learn to work with them to bring quality jobs here. I agree with what Bill said before. You know, you can't just, you know, go build a Walmart and, you know, people will come and they're going to work there. It's not an employment center. No, it's what we're looking for is the right business before the wave of the retail. That's where we need to focus our interest on. Good, productive buildings where people immediately go to work, because that employer has a demand for his product or his service. And those are the kind of developments that I think that we need to, as a government, county, city, from my perspective, together would be better, is to bring those kind of quality employers in here, because there's a demand for them. We can supply them with an educated workforce. We've got that going for us. You know, and that's what I want. I would love to see my kids to be able to work in this county, start their lives in this county, and raise their families here. But where we're at right now, I don't believe that we can do that. I don't see that. And keeping everything in balance is like I said, and from my perspective, we're at that crossroad. We can either go the wrong route or we can go the right route.
Jim?
Yes, I really appreciate your concern and your question. On the one hand, though, I have to say government, generally speaking, is only good if it has a balance, usually between two extremes. So a minute ago, we talked about business development. If you want to stop business development here, make everybody submit a business plan to the county when they want something rezoned, that the county has to say, you know, that's a pretty good business there. Nobody will come here. Okay, that's on the one hand. On the other hand, things could be worse in other, and are worse in other places. One of the reasons it's not worse here is because we, and I, will hold people's feet to the fire as much as I can, that we have rules, we have regulations, and you will conform to them when you build something here. And that causes several things to happen. The first thing that happens is if you're not a good or an experienced builder, or you're lazy or have a bunch of other negative things about you, you probably won't build here. The next thing that happens is it keeps everybody else's property values high, because we're keeping the quality of what does come in here at a higher level, and doesn't allow so easily a flight to the bottom. Smart Growth has one of the best examples that I know of about this, and that's the Academy Sports thing, in which we have an overlay district that talked about a certain amount of the building having a certain kind of a facade. Academy Sports came here and, of course, immediately said, we want exceptions to that, and if you don't give them to us, we're going to build elsewhere. We've got, I forgot the exact time frames, we got 2 months, we're making a decision. If you don't agree, we're going someplace else. Smart Growth and others stood up and said, I want this, the UDC and the overlay enforced to the commissioners. They were loud and clear on that issue. In the end, Academy built exactly what they were supposed to build. They opened up more or less in the time frame that they said that they would. They're there now, and as far as I know, people are buying there, which is really the key to this whole thing, which is why will people put up with a little extra hassle to deal with your Board of Commissioners and with the UDC? And the answer is because we provide a better market. The people who live here are a little higher heeled. They have similar attitudes about how things ought to be, by and large, and they want quality. They want a high quality of life, and they want things to work well. And so All those things have to roll together, which gets you better businesses, less empty buildings, higher quality building, and better neighbors, frankly, and high property values. That's my answer.
Yeah. Well, as far as all the empty buildings, that's pretty well for me. The economy just sucked the life out of things. A lot of people now are trying to rent lease buildings to folks, and they're having to give them 6 months to a year free just to try to draw people to fill these buildings. I believe if everything hadn't have done, you know, if the economy hadn't went like it did, I don't believe we'd be seeing as much empty buildings or lots, you know, that are around with grass growing 4 or 5 foot high. I don't believe that would have been the case if things had continued to roll along. But there's always come a time when things would slow up. We was just very fortunate, the whole US of A was very fortunate not to have a slowdown for, you know, 16, 18 years. When I was growing up, it was every 3 years. You'd have 3 good years, 1 bad year. And which a lot of investors, you know, they jumped on and they bankrupted. A lot of them bankrupted and can't, well, banks, has already been said, banks are not as eager to give money away as they was. And I think that's gonna hold things down to what it was. And I hope to see these empty buildings full again. When the economy begins to come back. And I've, like already been said, I believe we are in a good spot for the economy when it does come back. I believe Forsyth County is in a A-plus spot to draw businesses to fill these buildings and to fill these lots. People, you know, will begin, well, they've already been building new homes in the county, and that's, you know, that ain't going on too many places except here right now, and that's good for Forsyth, but we need to just keep an eye on it. Yeah, always, you know, I don't like seeing the empty buildings either, but I know and realize as an entrepreneur, they sometimes you bite off more than you chew, and that's what happened to a lot of people, and I'm sorry that that happened to them, and we having to deal with what's left after from them.
In the interest of time, we can keep moving along, but I would ask if you guys have anything substantive to add.
I would add just, I'll be short. Okay. Let's you want to go first?
We'll come back.
Okay, I'll be real brief. You know, the best thing that the government can do to encourage business is just get out of the way. With the exception of Colonel Brown's past employer, the government's really not very good at doing much about that. So we really don't need to be messing with the markets as far as the empty retail spaces and trying to, you know, we don't need to get involved in that. We need to let the markets, we need to let the economy come back, let the markets do their own thing. Although I will say, I will give you guys credit on the board. You've done some good things here recently by making it easier for people to restart projects. You just had that big subdivision, was it a Whelan, a John Whelan's subdivision, I'm thinking, where the people came and they said we wanted to start this back up, but they needed some variances. They wanted to load the buildings a little closer together, and they approved it. I mean, it was encouraging these guys to pick up these pipe farms and get them back up again, as opposed to going and expanding, making them easier to start the old projects back up. That's one of the things they can do. And you know, the pipe farms, rezoning, you're going back, they've done a lot of with the rezoning, going from trying to turn things back to agriculture. The people were had it zoned for residential and for business, and are now wanting to go back to agriculture. Let them do that. You know, there's a lot of different things they can do to help these things, help these dead projects get going. But for the most part, we don't want to start saying, no, you can't build here. You need to take this building instead. That's not our goal. So.
Okay. I agree with a lot that's been said, and I won't go over. I know that free market and things have to take care of itself. But I will tell you, I had a whole different experience from somebody that's so real estate, that's went through zoning, that, you know, I looked at things totally different. I got called by some people that live in Quail Hollow, that's out on Jotham Down Road. And it was zoned for 125 homes. And the minimum requirements were not what the developer was doing. And he built 27 homes. And these people paid $350 to $375 a house, but only 27 homes were built. And I was standing there, it gave me this whole different feeling because I was standing there looking at their beautiful homes and the developer bankrupt and the new people came in. They went by the minimum zoning requirements that was given, not what this developer was doing. And now these people are having homes built right beside them, all around them at $150,000 a home. And I thought, wow. Now this is from a country girl from North Forsyth that lives on 4.7 acres and that's tiny compared to what other people I live around have. And I never looked at, these are these people's life investment. And they've bought this and this is a 30-year loan and they have put everything in. And it's hard not to look at them and say, you know, I'd get out. You know, because you're never going to realize probably what you've got into it. And I know that's not maybe the best way to look at it, but where I'm getting at is that we are at a different time. And this Board of Commissioners have to look at things differently than the boards did in 2004 and 2005 when they had 50 and 60 zonings to deal with in a month. You know, it is a different time and it is a different, I look at property rights and I used to think the property rights belong, you know, to the farmer selling the property, and all of a sudden I'm standing on this half acre lot and I realize this is a big property right. This is something very important. And one other thing I wanted to mention on the inventory tax that was brought up, if you ask me, I would say I am against all tax and I love getting rid of tax and I think it's great. But I looked closely at the inventory tax when they first was brought up. Do you want to do away with the inventory tax? And immediately you think yes. Well, I called Matthew Ledbetter and I said, how much is the inventory tax? What kind of dollar amount are we looking at? And he gave me a number and then he called me back and said, no, the $3 million I gave you is wrong. It's going to be, they're estimating to be $5 million this year. And I said, okay, well, if we're going to do away with the $5 million, where are we going, what are we going to cut? And what are we going to do away with to get there? Or how are we willing to all pay higher taxes to do away with inventory tax? Well, I got to looking at that a big part of that, 60-something percent, Kristen, goes to the school board. So I called my friend on the school board and I said, I called Garland District 4 and I said, what do you feel about being able to cut your budget, you know, almost $4 million, $3 million to be able to do away with this inventory tax? And she said, I don't think we can cut it. I think all that it'll be, because we've cut, all we'll have to do is go up on the tax. So my point of that being to you is when you're asked to go vote for this, I mean, are you willing for your own taxes to go up so the inventory tax can go away? Because that's what it's going to boil down to.
Okay. We've got two folks who have not had a chance. Dennis, go ahead. Right now, you went last.
All right, I will be brief. That's a very good question. But I think as was stated earlier, you know, business plans are not for the government to approve or disapprove. That's for the bank to do. And I want to cite two examples. I did a zoning for a drugstore down in my district, and some people were upset about it, and they said, look, we don't need another drugstore. If you look down the street, the Eckerd has closed. So you're making a mistake by zoning another drugstore. Well, we zoned it, and it's doing great. And it's a CVS. And the reason the CVS does well and the Eckerd didn't is because the CVS had a better business plan than the Eckerd did. If you go to the Avenue Forsyth and you go to Marlowe's Tavern and try to get in there on a Saturday, you can't because they're packed full. But it used to be a little Ozzio's. And I'm in the business and it's a small place. And if you have all those kids in there, they're not spending any money. They're just driving out the adult customers. You don't need to write that down, Alyssa. But that's what they're doing if you're trying to attract an adult crowd. So, you know, some of this is a product of the market, but I'm gonna go ahead and touch on something that I did that was unpopular for some in 2007. And Mr. Wolf is here and he can tell you if whether or not I did the right thing. In 2007, at the first Board of Commissioners meeting, we put in a residential moratorium so people couldn't zone their property. I voted against that. The reason I voted against it is because in the last quarter of 2006, construction permits were down 28%. So the slowdown was already happening. And then to go ahead and intensify it just accelerated property values going down. What do you think about that, Mr. Real Estate Man?
I agree that market dynamic was already in place. The commissioners did not need to use government authority to do what was already naturally occurring.
That's right. We just intensified the lowering of property values. People couldn't sell their property. So it wasn't worth as much as something that was zoned next to them, like a piece of property. We took the value away from it. That was a bad move. And we're still trying to recover from it. Thank you for the question.
Just briefly, just a couple things. I live down in the south part of the county, of course. And if you drive up from Johns Creek up Peachtree Parkway, it's beautiful. And you get there, you know, the south part, you get there to the Publix, the first Publix. And Aberdeen subdivision there. You see that strip shopping center, it's changed hands two or three times on the right before you get to the Publix and over there behind the quarry. But one of the things I think that I disagree with, that I think we've added to the pipe farms and to the development problem, is we're competing in some cases with private industry. We're building state-of-the-art exercise machines and putting it in these recreation centers, and I just don't think that's government's business. I think it's good to build the rec centers and nice, but when we start competing with government, with local private investors, and two cases I know of, the building on the right that's there by the Sia grocery, right as you come in, that was a gym that went out of business. And if you go on down to Sharon Road at Peachtree Parkway, that there's a gym there. It's really, they're cutting their rates and they're really having a trouble competing. And then there was another one in front of Commonwealth Subdivision that was, they had put in all of the conduits for the exercise machines, and they just couldn't make a go of it because government's there providing it for what, $1,500 a year, which is not sustainable. It's gonna, at some point, those exercise machines run down, they're gonna have to be paid for out of our tax money. And I think it's wrong when we compete for with investors that are trying to make a go of their business, and it's already a rough economy, and they got the unlimited pockets of government competing with them. It's just, they just can't do it, so.
Well, I'd like to point out, since you brought up the rec centers, those aren't just exercise rooms that the rec centers are. I mean, there's no place in the county where you can play indoor basketball. So that's why we primarily built the recreation centers, other than the school gyms, which these kids can't get on.
Rec center's good. I was just talking about the state-of-the-art exercise machines.
And okay. The county offers classes there.
Is there anybody else with a burning question? We've got three questions. I think we're going to try to go through those. I'm going to be fairly draconian here and ask the folks to limit your questions to under a minute, because I would like to give each of you a chance to make a final statement. So let's start with you, ma'am.
This will be a real easy yes, no question. When you go down 141 Johns Creek, that area there, it's absolutely beautiful. My hat's off to whoever decided what could be built, color, the fantastic job. You get up to a couple of exits before me, 14, you get to the intersection of, I think it's Atlanta Road. First of all, I've only lived here for 2 years, okay? Atlanta Road and exit 14, it just looks like a dump. It's looked like a dump for God knows how long. Do you have any ability to encourage the owners or investors to clean up their act a bit without necessarily governing them?
And specifically, you're maybe talking about the median on 141?
No, not the medium 141. I'm talking about the area at exit 14. And then you turn left. Yes. And I think it's Atlanta Road and 20 or Buford Highway or something. I mean, it's just title loans here, and the Kroger has been abandoned. And I mean, it's just dirty. Other than the new McDonald's that's been built. But nonetheless, coming into Forsyth County is exquisite. The further you go north, and the rural part is very attractive. I'm not saying that. But we've got an awful lot of stuff there and junk there. And it's been there for 30 years because we have family here. We've been up back and forth for 30 years. We just only got to move here 2 years ago.
That's actually the city's property, right?
Yeah, part of it is that you're in the city in some of the areas you were talking about. And that's a different government.
Okay. What? Again, not understanding. So that's city?
Some of it. I don't know. I don't know each and every place that you were saying, but some of it is, yes.
So she's talking about the intersection at 20 and Highway 9.
Yeah.
Right there with the...
Yeah, you mean like Spondivitz, which is closed?
Yeah.
Next to the fish place?
Publix is there. The new Cracker Barrel is there.
The Kroger's closed there.
The Kroger's closed down. Is that the city?
Yes.
Okay. My apologies.
Well, thank God $5 million of your property tax goes to that city.
And the water.
And the water.
But your question is, would they support some, and it doesn't have to be that. For example, the Highway 141 corridor, I will disagree with you. I think that you know when you come in Forsyth County, because you drive out of Johns Creek and it looks lovely and manicured, and then you're in Forsyth County and you've got nothing but scrub grass in the middle of the median. There's no trees. There's trash blown all over the place. So the question sort of writ large.
And that's with an overlay.
That's with an overlay. So would you or would you not support?
Is there a way to encourage the landowners, the investors, to clean up their act a bit without you governing them?
Okay.
So to speak?
There you go. 1 minute. Start on the end. We'll work our way down.
1 minute. If you're talking about 141, the answer is, I mentioned it earlier, is a community improvement district. It's called a CID. That's what they have in some different areas of Gwinnett County. That's what they have in Windward. You know, it's like if you live in a subdivision, you pay dues, and your monument sign area looks good, your amenities, pool, tennis area looks good. They would band together. The Chamber of Commerce is spearheading this. It's been to the in front of the General Assembly last year. I hope they take it up this year, where they would form their own organization to pay to install landscaping and then pay to maintain it themselves, and it would add to their property values. And for the most part, it's been well received, but it has to be voted on at the General Assembly, and that won't be till January.
Dennis?
I think a lot of improvements are when you have the private efforts or businesses like Chick-fil-A. If you start up at 400 there at the avenues, I think Chick-fil-A owns part of that. You know, the Adopt the Road program, but the farther you get south, the less and less you see of that. Maybe it's just because there's not as many businesses in the area. But I think if you have a private partnership with the county and with concerned individuals and businesses, and just have some dialogue there, I think we could probably get a lot more voluntary type effort towards adopting those and working on it until we get a lot more businesses in the area. I think because of the taxes on these commercial districts are a lot more if we say agree to pay them, but I think there's a lot of voluntary effort that can be done as we see around the avenues, and as far as you get south, it's just where the vacant shopping centers are, you just don't have that much input anymore because there's no business there.
Okay, time. Jim?
I relinquish my time.
Okay. John?
You know, there's a lot of things that you can do. The CID is a good way to start out. The problem with it is that it takes a long period of time to pull together because all of the major landowners have to be contacted. They have to agree to it. They have to pay the assessment, which is like a tax to them. It's going to be collected by the tax commissioner. So that takes a while to accomplish all that. Those are all good things, and hopefully you can move in that. And there's going to be some cooperative spirit that they're going to want from the county's perspective. But in the meantime, there are great organizations out there like Keep Forsyth County Beautiful, who has the ability to go out and get grant money, or to develop a program where businesses could donate to them and they can improve those districts in cooperation with the businesses. So that's the county and the local businesses working together to make a better community. That would be an excellent place to start.
Okay, I'll have to agree with Mr. Tannell.
Yeah, I'm kind of with Dennis and Jim here. You know, private, if we can get private organizations involved, fine, but it's really not the government's role. I mean, there's ordinances that have to be followed. You know, if somebody wants to grow their grass 2 feet tall, there's really, it's not government's business to tell them not to.
Well, we do have a piece of parkway overlay.
Well, exactly. There's ordinances and park and overlays, right.
Yeah. But I just need to chime in. That's a DOT road. They're not going to do adopt roads.
Okay, I don't even know. I'm not really sure what road.
If they're talking about 141.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, you can do that with GDOT. It takes a long time. They have programs, they have funding that you can get. It can be done, but again, there's got to be a spirit of cooperation. It's not government going down there and cracking a whip.
Cindy?
I'm with Jim.
Okay, you're done?
I'm done. Okay.
Question number two.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Dan Wolf, I'd like to focus my question on the 25% impervious surface issue that we're told is now going to become another major state mandate, apparently. I think we've already heard you raise the question as to the validity of what we would call the science behind this. Would any of you as commissioners be willing to really push on that issue as to the validity of the science which they use to be their just cause to impose this on the counties? So often these environmental zealots come up with concepts and then mandate it, and some of it almost begins to approach junk science, or there's so much more to the story, or there's ways to mitigate, or there's new technology. There's just so many more pieces to these gearboxes. And so that's my question. Would you all be willing to pursue that deeply, in detail, so that the whole North Metro group of counties could say, we beg to appeal this, stop, get with the legislators, back this thing up, and make sure we're not living under a body of law that is onerous and not even scientifically valid, or could have a lot of room for improvement. That's my question.
Okay, sir.
Kind of yes or no?
Yeah, go ahead.
Within reason. You know, within reason. I realize government gets out of hand. As we talked about the 25%, 20% earlier. You know, if they start getting this out of reason, when they just sat down and say, whoa, hold on. Let's look at something a little. We need to look at this a little different. You know, there's a lot of times somebody else's survey versus somebody else is completely different. You know, and that's something you need to sit down, and if they come up with some astronomical amount, that's when we're going to have to say, wait, let's look at it. We're going to look at it, then let's get together. After everybody gets theirs, then come up and see if we can't come up with a common ground without arguing and bickering over this and said this and said that. We can come up and, you know, get in the middle, I mean, if it is that way. But I would like to see, I'm sorry.
Yeah, actually I think that's the job we're applying for. How are we gonna fix a problem if we can't define it? Let's get true definitions of the problem and then we can deal with it. Then we can work out some real solution.
I agree, but I think it's a state issue too, and I think our local delegation, I heard Mike Dungeon speak on this not long ago at a Council for Quality Growth meeting, and he highly questions the science behind it. And he's been meeting with lots of different people on it. So sure. I think it is an issue that needs to be looked at.
John?
Yeah, I'll go back to what I said earlier. You know, I think in the beginning, it's all about collecting the right data and starting from the right baseline. And if we can get to that point and try to move forward, it is a very complex issue because of the things that I pointed out before, soil type, slope type, you know, vegetation, habitat. to me, it's a very interesting subject. I would like to understand the science behind it, because I'm not a firm believer that there's only one solution to a problem. It has to be a mix. And we have the technology in place. And at the end of the day, it's all about maintaining or improving water quality. And again, whether you're talking about the Big Creek watershed, the Etowah or the Chattahoochee, whether you, this county, you're in the upstream or the downstream, the responsibility is all the same. And we have a responsibility as a county to the people that are in other counties downstream from us. I would like that to be based on science.
Jim?
Simple answer is yes. The expanded answer is we need 2 more feet of water in Lake Lanier. Thank you very much.
We need what, Jim?
2 more feet of water in Lake Lanier.
1073.
Okay.
Kenneth?
Yes, and why haven't we done it already?
Brian?
I think I answered it earlier and said yes.
All right, our final question for the night, and then we'll go to Oregon State.
I'd like to build an other side of the equation, dealing with commercial strip shopping centers, rather than a building plan, okay? Is there a posture that you as candidates would approach to dealing with our existing strip shopping centers when we have new businesses that want to open and they want to start from scratch on brand new property and everything? Is there a posture we could take, or you could take as commissioners, to approach how you would deal or direct them towards particular sites that might meet their requirements and not change the impervious, increasing the impervious pavement and so on?
So your question to them is do they have a position on
using
existing
unused
store frontage lots, etc.
That's already paved and already electric and everything, exactly. To try to reduce the number of those.
Okay. I'll start at the other end.
Yes, and yes we have. Most notably, we have adjusted sewer plans, sewer master plans, to try to attract people, and curb cuts to help with traffic flows. So, the doors are open, our doors are open for somebody to come in and say, look, this used to be a little Ozio's and we want to make it a Marlowe's. Instead of taking our Marlowe's and building something somewhere else. So, yes.
Okay. Dennis?
Sure. Yes, absolutely. And this looks like a prime opportunity for the chamber. It looks like something would be right up their alley about, advertising throughout Metro Atlanta. If we have this much existing square foot of this type and it would support these type businesses. So, and maybe have these regional economic development forums where we advertise that on a continuing basis, not just come to Forsyth County and build, but hey, we've already got this plug and play, ready to move in kind of stuff sitting there that wouldn't negatively impact the impervious service limitation. So there's lots of creative things that we can do, and I think that this would be one that we should really load the chamber down with.
Okay. Jim?
I either don't understand the question or I don't have a solution for you. I'm sorry.
Okay, do you want me to rephrase the question?
No, I think I do understand it. I just don't have any good ideas for you.
One of the things that you're going to see, and I'm already seeing it in my line of business, is that those retail centers that's the other shoe that's about to drop in the commercial real estate market, okay? A lot of them are quickly approaching foreclosure. And what you're seeing is developers or investors are out there and they're trying to get those properties for, pennies on the dollar, if you will. In fact, we're getting ready to start a huge, major expansion of a retail center that is just god-awful. But by the time the developer gets done with it, it'll be somewhat akin to a Vicary Village or a Woodstock downtown. And what we need to do is to try to encourage those businesses here. We've got to help them try to create the demand
so that they will want to locate here. Right now, our problem is that demand is closer to 285 than it is Forsyth County. So they'll gobble that up and eventually move this way, and I hope that we meet them with open arms.
Tim? Not to use a lot of time, yes.
it all kind of ties in with the last year. I mean, remember we heard a story about a woman opening a wine and cheese shop. That's great. That woman is employing herself. She'll have a few part-time employees. She's not going to have offer benefits. That's not a real employer. But if we could attract real employers, then with that will come the wine and cheese shops. With that will come. It's Reaganomics. You know, eliminate the inventory tax. Business will make it easier for them to do business. Businesses hire people, they grow, they hire people, people spend money, they move in, they buy houses, they go to retail shops. We need to get major employers, we need to get people offering living wages, benefits here to the county, and not keep thinking about growth as retail. We've got to have we have to have manufacturing, and then those places will fill up.
But I think if I understand you correctly, you're talking about existing buildings like retail strips that are already there, and why not? I'm not sure what all government can do to entice. You know, a lot of those buildings are probably, like somebody said, tied up with a bank waiting on it to be sold. But I think that it's worth exploring, and if we could offer some type of incentive and work with the chamber to try to drive that in some way, then yes, that's a very positive thing.
All right, thank you everyone for your questions and for your patience allowing everybody to provide their two cents.
Can I just make one statement?
No.
Oh, no.
Jack Leeson, Smart Growth, Forsyth. I would just like to let all the candidates know how short 3 minutes felt to you. I go up and I speak, everybody who goes, they see me speak all the time. I just wanted you to understand now how short 3 minutes feels.
You don't realize how long 3 minutes is.
That's good.
We done?
Okay, it's up to you guys, but I would like to give the candidates 1 minute each to do their closing statement. But you can tell them no.
Please stand so we can
Yeah, okay, so let's start with District 4, then we'll do District 5, and we'll end with District 2. Cindy, you go first, we'll just go straight down the line. And why don't you come up here, because you're addressing everybody.
I want to thank you all for coming, especially you that hung around to the very end. You deserve some type of a medal, pat on the back. I thank all of you that participate in Smart Growth. I applaud any community activists or community involvement where people, I think it makes us all better. And that's why I applaud transparency in government. I love to see people engaged, and I think that's what makes our community all that it can be and helps us all to be better. We might not always agree, but we can agree to disagree, and hopefully we can see each other's side and make our community and our world a little bit better. So I thank you. I don't know how many people are in here from District 4. I think we all have a lot of, we share a lot of common interests. Let me
there
talk
is.
To you. I'll go, me and you will go right there and talk in just a minute. Stay away. But I want to, I hope that you will consider, I hope you will consider voting for me. I promise that I will do I will be honest, I will be fair, and I'll do a good job for you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your time tonight. Like she said, this has been a long one or a late one, so thank you very much for sticking it out. Go to Mulrooney.com, go to my website to see my history, my ideas, my thoughts on all the issues, water and lost and 25% impervious. Just leave you with this, it's kind of strange that I'm actually speaking before Mr. Hubbard here, because normally with these things, it's become I'm the last guy. Believe it or not, Mulrooney is the last person alphabetically among the five candidates for District 4. So I have a new way of thinking. When you get to, if we're the one guy, when you get to the to the ballot and you're looking at who to vote for, just go straight to the bottom of the list. Vote none of the above. Yeah, have a good night.
Somebody wrote one time is none of the above, didn't you? Anymore? I'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight and taking time out of your busy schedule and allowing us this opportunity. I tell you, I love the camp. And I see things will one day turn around and we'll be back going just like we was. So don't get discouraged, mainly. Let's just all work together and continue to go forward. And as far as everybody that has stuck around for the whole duration, I want to thank you. And there's plenty of brownies and still some cookies and some coffee left for your prize. But we do thank y'all. And if, whenever we get down to July 31st, we would appreciate your vote and your support. And I believe you'll be very happy with the job that I will do for you to represent you. Thank you.
I too want to thank you for coming out, and in particular for hanging in there tonight. It dwindled down pretty quickly, but you guys are real troopers, so I appreciate that. You know, to me, this is really what this is all about. It's about getting stakeholders, you know, folks like yourself, people like us, people like Smart Growth in the same room talking about issues. And that's what I want to say to you in my closing remarks, okay? Things are going to get interesting from here to July 31st. This is the important time to participate. This is not about good and evil, at least not from my perspective. I'm not going to make it about that. This is about issues, people and their ideas, and working hard for you. Okay? I'm up here for the same reason that you're there. It's that simple. Now, this takes a little bit more personal courage to get up on this side of the podium, but I'm willing to do it. You know, I think I've got thick skin, but I'm only up here for you. And so what I ask all of you that came here tonight to do is at least show up on July 31st.
Yeah.
That's the important thing. Exercise your right to vote. There are a lot of people out there in this world doing difficult things in god-awful places so that you can go to that poll on the 31st. And that's all I can ask of you. Thank you.
I do agree it's about getting in the same room together. The issue is about voting, and it's also about voting for somebody who has the time and commitment to do what you would like them to do. The first time I ran for at least a year, I went to virtually every single commissioner work session and commissioner meeting before I was put in a position to be able to do anything. Some of my opponents' time has not been able to be given granted to do anything like that because he has a job. I'm retired. I have been retired. He's got a business which he has to tend to. So you need to vote for somebody who has the time and has shown the commitment and has the experience. But to help you to do that, I meant to bring my other thing. My last name is Boff. It's like turn off the light with the B in front of it. And when you go to vote, it's best one for Forsyth or best one for five, District 5, Jim Boff. Thank you.
You know, they're often maligned, but they do a great job. They bring issues up that you're going to have to deal with. So whether you're an environmentalist or a developer, the key to success here and not making the same mistakes that other counties have made is a balanced approach. We've got to listen to all sides and come up with the best solution so we don't become like a Gwinnett County or a DeKalb County. And I grew up in Cobb County, so I've seen it happen. That balance is so important. So we can learn from the mistakes that have been made in other counties and just not make the same ones, because we're uniquely positioned
to be one of the premier counties into the 21st century that's ever been. And I say that without any kind of embellishment. So I have plenty of time to do this because I'm retired. I am looking for a job. So I'm going to need something to do. So I would appreciate your support. Early voting July 9th. And vote D. Brown. And hopefully I'll get a chance to make a difference. Thank you.
Do I get like 15 minutes, Bob?
Three.
Sorry. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you all. I'd like to thank you for your interest in Forsyth County government. When I first spoke this evening, the first thing I said was that, it began 8 years ago. That's when I decided I was going to run because I wanted to make a difference. And I want to tell you the state of the Board of Commissioners back then was we had three races in District 5, 2, and 4, and all of the incumbents wouldn't run. There's something to be said for stability in government on a local issue, on a local level. We're the fastest growing county in the state of Georgia. There's a reason for that. It's because people want to live here. We do things right. I said when I first sat down, or when I first spoke, that it was about involving the public. On Saturday, State Attorney General Sam Owens came here and reaffirmed his commitment to me by saying that I was committed to open and transparent government, and I have set a high standard of service and dedication for my fellow commissioners across the state of Georgia. I've just always tried to involve people, whether I meet them in a dirt parking lot or in this type of forum, we'll work it out.
Thank you.
talking. Okay.